Since the dawn of civilization, mankind has looked out at the stars and asked the question, are we alone? Are we all that there is? Mankind's fascination with the stars has driven him to build giant megaliths in earth and stone, and none greater than the great pyramids at Giza in Egypt, the Inca, Aztec, and Mayan temples of South America, and the giant earthen mounds and stone circles here in southern England. In 1976, mankind launched his first coded messages to an extraterrestrial intelligence aboard the Voyager spacecraft, which is now leaving our solar system for interstellar space. Some people now believe that we began to receive messages back from space far sooner than we could possibly have imagined, in the shape of these crop circles. Crop formations have grown in numbers and complexity throughout the years and are now a worldwide phenomena. In 1990, the world's attention was drawn to this valley in the Vale of Puisey by the media who published this photograph, the first crop formation of its kind, which quickly dispensed with any skeptical contemporary theory that they were mere wind damage. Since then, people have been arriving from all over the world, and many eyes have been watching these and other fields in this area for clues as to the identity of the circle makers. Hi, I'm Reg Presley, and welcome. I first became interested in crop circles in 1990. And by 1992, I went on my first watch. We were looking at the fields over the Vale of Puisey, and I was talking to Colin Andrews and looking over his shoulder at the same time, when suddenly a star appeared from nowhere, very low in the sky, and that's what I thought it was. The only difference was that it was moving slowly to the right across the valley and going up and down in brightness. I thought first that it may be a plane as well, but no noise. It travelled very quietly, very silently across the valley. When it arrived at the other side, it seemed to dip as though it was going out, and then came to about five times the brightness and was an orange colour. The very next day, there was a formation exactly where this light was hovering. Now, I couldn't put my finger on anything that it could have been, not from this planet, because as it left, it quickly went down to a small point of light and then shot away, bleeping as it went. A year later, in 1993, on a rather dismal night with five people at Knapp Hill, I saw the most strangest thing that I've ever seen. And this particular night, it started to drizzle, and the weather gradually deteriorated. It was low cloud cover that night, and there were five sat there looking out across the valley towards Stonehenge. As we watched, at about 20 past 12, two silver objects, discs, flew through the underlying cloud, clipping the bottom of the cloud, within about 10 to 15 seconds of one another. We looked at one another and couldn't understand what it could have been. We thought maybe there was lights shining up onto the cloud, but you realize that they would have used the bottom of the cloud as the light swept across. These were objects actually cutting through the cloud. This we saw with our own eyes. But 1 hour after this, a light came on. It was about twice the size of the moon, turquoise in colour. And from that light, as if somebody drops a stone in water, the expanding light, an expanding light, white, came from that and actually engulfed us all. Again, you cannot say what it is, but it was not lightning. The two objects that went through were not jets. They didn't make any noise. And when you see your first UFO, you're convinced that somebody is coming here. Believe me. That brings me on to the Roswell situation. On the 2nd of July 1947, a supposed UFO crashed at Roswell, New Mexico. Approximately 300 to 500 people were involved in the debris site, clearing the debris site, and those that knew about it totaled approximately 500. The army then turned round and told them that it was a weather balloon. They send these weather balloons up. The strange thing is that these weather balloons are made of the same material that you make condoms. Are you trying to tell me that the 509th, which is stationed very close and who were at the crash site, cannot tell the difference between a condom and a UFO? If you ask scientists, do they believe in life on other planets? They immediately say, yes, there has to be, because the law of averages is there's so many planets out there that there must be life.
Well, here we are at the Romsey Craft Show. We're actually on the Broadlands Estate, and we're going to have a little wander around. We've got a thatching company. I can see a shooting gallery. There's loads of food. There are GGs, knick-knack stalls, masses to see. Let's go and have a look. Wocko the Woodman. I don't know, did you make that name up to sound like really cool, or is that your name really Wocko?
No, my real name is Hoyd Winston Watkins. And ever since I was that big and couldn't actually say Hoyd Winston Watkins, I've been called Wocko.
I think that's really cool. Yeah, Wocko, exactly. What are you doing today? You were just sort of showing me these slats of wood. You're doing something quite unusual with these slats, aren't you?
Yes, I'm making oak laths, or as they say in the deep south, laths for plastering. And these laths will be used for restoration work in timber frame buildings. They're thin strips of wood like that.
Tell us what's special about what you're doing, because there's a tree trunk over there that's part of this story, isn't there?
Yes. Now, this is a 200-year-old oak, which until last Thursday was growing about 250 yards away from my cottage.
And you chopped it down? You killed it?
I chopped it down because I thought, now is the time. And normally when I make these things, I just sling them in a pile, just bundle them up with a bit of old binder twine like that. Don't even use proper tree wood. But I thought, I know, I'll do something really clever. I'll save all the bits and pieces and put them back together to form a complete tree.
Let's have a look at the machine.
Well, I am the machine.
What do you call this machine? You are the machine, yes. But what do you call all this?
This is called a brake.
Well, give us a break.
No, it's just called a break for breaking wood opening.
Right. What are these things that hold it together?
This is because this is a mobile one. When I'm working in the wood, I'll just drive a couple of bits into the ground,
right.
Nail a couple of bits across.
It sounds so sort of glamorous, doesn't it, when I'm working in the wood?
Now, I really think that you ought to do it.
Oh, yes, please.
Yes. I'll start it off.
Okay.
I'll start it off, and then I'll decide where we're going to put the first...
Okay.
..the first doobie. I ought to do it by eye, but I won't. I'll do it by guesswork.
So we're doing a doobie by eye?
Yes.
And then I'm going to do with my hitometer.
We're going to split this down. When I nod my head, you hit it.
With that bit?
Yes. Yes. Go on, hit it.
Ah!
And again. You're obviously not used to hitting your boyfriend, are you? Go on, give it some welly.
Oh, my hand. Have I got to make... Oh,
hang on.
Okay, I'm getting into this now, John. No, don't stop me. I'm in mid-flow.
No, that'll never do. There you
go. Okay, go on, you do it then.
No.
Oh, I'm exhausted. Oh, I made a cut.
Yes, you made a cut.
Quick, Jace, look, I've made a cut.
I've got a thing here called a grandmother corrector.
Oh, blimey.
Well, it's really a mother-in-law corrector.
Oh, goodness.
There you are.
You're so strong.
Oh, wow.
I couldn't have done that. So that's the first split.
And then you... crack it like
you
that.
Make it look really easy.
And you carry on. And on and on, until it is as thin as
there. As is in the corner.
There.
I'm quite impressed, actually. You have to. You can't do that after a glass of wine, can you? There are a few little signs on here. You do pegs, and you do. What else do you do?
Charcoal.
Charcoal. Yeah. Tell us about your other
charcoal,
major skills.
Tent pegs. Tent pegs.
Go on, then. Show us a tent peg.
Then you put it on here. One little cut there, so you can hold your rope. Cut it there. Shave those little bits off. Because you know what delicate hands these marquee boys have, you know. Don't want them getting splinters or anything like that. And as the French say,
well,
voila.
So are you drumming up a lot of trade today?
I've sold 6 tent pegs today.
Have you? You're a rich man.
I was hoping to sell one to you as well.
Oh, well, I haven't got a tent.
Oh.
Anybody want a tent
mine.
Peg?
You can borrow mine.
We're selling tent
Plenty
pegs.
Plenty of room in my tent.
Oh, all these offers, I really can't cope.
Mind you, we've got no sides to it. You'll have to be hardy.
So what else do you want to tell me about, John? And what else do you do in your... Is this a company? Is it a local company?
No. I'm an estate worker.
Right.
I work on an estate who you've probably never heard of.
Well, I probably won't have. I only know this one.
This is Nebworth Estate in Hertfordshire.
I've heard it. That'd be funny. You're having a laugh, aren't you?
Yeah. You'll certainly hear of it next weekend, anyway.
Yes, I think so,
We've got some very wet people.
We'll hear it.
Yes, you'll hear it. Well, my woods are about 150 yards behind the stage.
I see.
Yeah.
So you're going to be famous part of Nebworth then?
No, I'm going to keep well away. I'm going to keep well away.
Well, it's been a pleasure meeting you, John.
It's been a pleasure meeting
quite
you.
Quite a character, really, aren't you?
And you're a lovely looking lass
yourself. Thank you, darling. Well, we're going to leave you to your wood cutting.
It's a pity no one's married you yet.
Yeah, I know. What a shame. No. I'm on the show.
Oh, dear.
Anyway,
my brother will marry you.
Really?
Yes, he's a vicar.
I was going to say, give me your number. I'm in my number.
Bye-bye. Look
See
after
you.
Yourself. Don't
Bye.
Work too hard.
I won't.
Yeah.
The bakery stall and I wasn't allowed to buy any cakes. I'm very upset about that. I'm with Mandy Flynn and her glass blowing creations. Animals mainly, Mandy?
All sorts of animals and figures from fantasy, fact, fiction, right way across the board.
How did you start up with this?
Right. I learned making ships and bottles.
With a company?
With a company based in Lymington.
Mm-hmm.
And when the owner of that company retired, I set up in partnership with another colleague from that company. And we've since gone our own way into doing this.
What attracts you to animals? Why?
I just enjoy the form, basically.
Right. How do you get it right? Explain a little bit about the art of making an animal from scratch.
We start with a solid rod, so
right.
They're manipulated rather than blown.
Right.
And it's a case of working through gradually and just shaping it. We use...
So you use something else to shape it rather than just the flame?
Yeah, just a knife and tweezers. It's our basic equipment.
So where do you sell these animals then? Do you have a shop outlet?
No, I don't. I just do a few craft fairs and things.
Is it a creative thing for you more than a job? Is it that you just enjoy the finished article? Is that the pleasure, finishing a piece?
Yeah, it's the actual making of it. That's what I enjoy.
What inspires you to make these fantasy figures? Where do you get your ideas from?
All sorts. But mostly they just come out of my head.
Do they?
Yeah.
So you've got a wild imagination?
Yeah, pretty wild.
I have to say, it's very hot down here. Do you ever sort of... Yeah, it's almost like getting a suntan, isn't it?
Yeah, in the summer I find it very hard work.
Yeah. Did you get many burns then?
Yeah, I've got quite a few scars.
And no hairs on your arms, sort of thing.
That's right.
So how near are you to finishing this cat?
He's just got to have his hind legs and then be finally shaped up.
I see. So how are you going to do the hind legs?
Well, I've got one forming there. And I'm going to put his bottom paw on... like that, just so that he's got his toes.
Oh,
toe.
Gosh!
I join it onto the solid piece, and then using the flame, I can pull it off at whatever shape or point I want. And it does, I tend to shape it automatically now. I'm not really thinking about
really?
It.
Really? Thinking about your shopping list for next week?
Yeah. And then with the help of a knife, I can just bring it round and you can get more...
What's that?
Detail.
You're just making definition and...
It is, yeah. Just adding a little bit.
So you can make them quite interesting and the intricate faces, can you as
can,
well?
You can, yeah.
Now, how come the heat... Maybe I'm being silly here, but how come the heat is not travelling up the tube?
Because glass is a very poor conductor.
Because you're very near to the flame, aren't
yeah,
you, even
I
so?
Yeah, I can get my hands quite close.
And that helps, obviously.
Yeah.
Have you ever been asked, have you ever been commissioned to do anything specific, like perhaps somebody's pet or anything like that?
Yes, we've done things for, from people's photographs of animals and things, portrait pieces.
That's rather nice, isn't it? To be able to give something to somebody that's actually really
yes,
very personal.
Yes, it is. I think one of the more exciting things that we've done is a while ago we were commissioned to do a large glass palace for a ghost story on the television.
Really?
Yeah.
How long did that take you to do?
110 hours.
No. Would you use it just to this sort of flame or a larger piece of equipment?
No, just small flames.
Really?
Yeah.
What was the programme? Can we advertise?
It was on about 2 years ago on TBS, before it went to Meridian, The House of Glass. It was a ghost story.
Also, you've got quite a lot of colour glass. How do you integrate the colour into the glass?
The colour's added afterwards, it's painted on, and then it's fired in a kiln. And
to seal it?
Yeah, it's very much like a pottery glaze. The colour comes in as... the glass gets hot, it fires into the surface of the glass.
Right. It's tough in the tent land, I'm telling you. I don't know who's got a harder job, me interviewing people on my knees or Mandy by the flame. Mandy, I've just had a look at some of your creations. You've really got something to suit all tastes, haven't you? You've got from the classical sort of lady on the horse to this amazing set of fantasy figures, really. These wonderful dragons and even a waterfall.
Yeah.
It's incredible. So where do you go from here? Are you going to keep doing this sort of work or do you change from year to year?
It goes with the flow, basically, whatever people want. As you say, there's something for everybody.
Do you find if you ever go on a holiday and you're inspired by a local custom or something like that, that you might want to create something you've seen?
Yeah, and certainly animals and things away.
Mm.
I don't know, dreams and things.
Really? Wake up and write it all down?
A film on the TV or something. It comes from all sorts of places.
Well, there you go. Mandy Flynn and her glass animals. You've got to look out for her at craft fairs because you're not in a shop, are you?
No.
So come down and have a look because they're absolutely fantastic. Thanks, Mandy. Great to meet you.
My name is Jerry Holt, owner of Magic Carpets, speaking to you from Winchester Street in Salisbury, and I'm going to show you how you can save a pile on carpets. For my next trick, we have got some special offers at £7.99 a square metre for bleach-proof and stain-proof carpet, with free gripper, free fitting and free door bars. Not funny, but good value for money. And don't forget, if you can't come to us, we'll come to you. If you enjoyed the advert, it's Jerry Holt at Magic Carpets. If you didn't, it's Paul Daniels.
For that special meal, visit our candlelit cellar restaurant at the Fairlawn Hotel in Amesbury High Street. Stay and dine in this romantic setting and choose from a delicious menu of Italian or English cuisine. For hotel and table reservations, call us now on Amesbury 01980 624 989.
Oh, morning. What a wonderful day here in Salisbury. The sun's shining and what a perfect day to go for a ride on a bike, isn't it?
It is.
I'm with Derek Hable, Hable Motorcycles, here in Salisbury. Lovely, isn't it?
It certainly is.
Beautiful
yep.
Day.
Beautiful day.
Derek rang us up and said, you keep seeing all these cars being tested on town TV and the cars are tested in the newspapers and things, but we never see anybody road testing a bike. So we're going to set that right, aren't we?
We are. This morning we have a Yamaha TRX 850 that will do the business on today.
I hear you riding it yesterday, the Isle of Wight, weren't you?
Yep. Yeah. Beautiful bike.
Is
just,
it?
Just making sure it's okay, yep.
How long have you been here in Salisbury, Rick?
This particular premises here on Churchfield's 91.
Really?
Yes.
Yeah. You're doing well, so it's a good local success story, right?
It is.
Brilliant. So what sort of bikes do you sell here? I mean, you see Yamahas all over the place.
Well, we have a full range of Piaggio mopeds and the Vespa scooters, with all the models of Yamaha as well.
Yeah?
Every model, yep.
Well, what's this big old lump behind me here? What's that?
We also do a lot of Japanese imports.
Yeah. That's the old Honda Goldwing, isn't it?
It is, yes.
What a size. That must be a bit heavy, too.
It is, yeah.
What's it like to ride?
It's a certain niche in the market for that.
So, this is the one you were riding yesterday, is it?
This is it.
And this is the Yamaha 850.
That's the 850 twin.
Yeah.
Yeah, the new model for Yamaha this year.
Really? Somebody says a bit like a Ducati.
Is that right?
It's very similar. Yeah. Yes, it's very similar. It's not a V-twin, it's a vertical twin.
Yeah.
But very similar in design with the frame and superb road holding.
What's the sort of top speed on these days? I know it's obviously you can't go more than 70 miles an hour, but...
Well, it has a lot of acceleration, a lot of pull from 100 mile an hour.
Really?
A lot of pull, yes.
Really? Right, Aubrey, you're going to ride this for us then?
Yes, I'm going to take it for a test ride.
You're a bit of a biker then?
I am indeed, yes, I teach motorcycle.
Do you?
And run a motorcycle training school, yes.
Well, besides cars as well?
Yes.
We saw you doing the cars last week, which was very good.
Yeah, we also do lorries and motorcycles, yes.
Well, I'm glad. So, all right, well, you get yourself kitted up. And we're going to follow you. I think we're going to go to the Pheasant on the Salisbury Road, don't we?
We are, and have a non-alcoholic drink or something.
I have a shandy or something, yeah. Well, I'm not driving, but you're riding. So. Okay, I'm going to look forward to this. It's going to be really good. The first time ever. A bike test on Town TV.
Lovely.
All right, well, we'll see you on the open road.
Okay.
Cheers, Aubrey. Well, all you Salisbury viewers and Andover viewers know where we are on the busy main road between Andover and Salisbury. And we're outside the Glorious Pheasant. And we're looking for our friend Aubrey. Oh, and here he comes. They are back from his incredible road test. So, there he is. You survived then, Aubrey.
I did indeed.
How was it?
That was brilliant.
Was it?
Yeah.
Well, take your helmet off. You can tell us all about it. Just a sec. I may even buy you a Coca-Cola or something. Mustn't plug too much on Town TV, but what a lovely day to be riding a bike.
Wonderful. Wonderful. What a wonderful machine.
Is it good?
It is good. It is good. Very torquey.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you took it easy, though, and you didn't throw it into too many roundabouts too quickly.
Oh, no. No, indeed not. No. It's when it's, you know, don't want to scratch it.
Yeah. So what are the most impressive features of it? Or have you any criticisms at all?
No, there's no real criticism. It's an out of town bike.
Yeah.
You know, it's wants to get up and go.
Does it?
It's definitely a get up and go rider.
So on the open road.
It's definitely an open road machine, yes. But a lovely ride.
Is it?
Yes, definitely a lovely ride.
So this is their brand new bike, is it? The Yamaha.
Yeah. It's a very strong engine. It pulls from the bottom. You know, it does everything you'd expect of a performance bike.
But come here, Steve. There's not a lot of room on the back. Look, for I don't know whether the good lady can sit on the back or not. Do you think so?
Well, I don't know, really. I don't sit on her back.
I don't know where she put her legs, but I presume there's a little footrest lip which comes out. You can sit on there. I wonder if Steve, the cameraman, could get on the back. I suppose he could. No, he says he's saying not, but you never know. One of these days he might tempt him on. But well, you think it's a good bike?
It's a lovely bike. It is definitely a lovely bike. Yes.
That's smashing. So we're going to go on in to Andover now, aren't we?
We are indeed.
So that should be great fun. Where are we going now? Thruxton Motorcycles.
Thruxton Motorcycles, yes.
Okay, so it's a motorbike show this week here on Town TV, so I think we'll just have a quick Coca-Cola first or something like that. And we'll see you in just a minute on the open road again. Isn't it wonderful? Well, here comes Aubrey. We beat him to it. What kept you then?
Oh, the traffic.
You go for a scenic tour or what?
Definitely. Tour it all day.
So to sum up, you think this is pretty good value for money?
It's a pretty good value for money motorcycle, yes.
You say it's on the road bike.
It's an out of town bike, but it's certainly good value for money.
Okay, splendid. Okay, well, we're now outside Threxham Motorcycles, of course, and we're going to have a word with Tony Holland. I think he's got something else for you to have a look at.
He has indeed.
Yeah, so something called a Thunder Race, he tells me. So we're going to go and have a word with him.
Okay.
So come on over here, Aubrey. We're going motorbike mad on Tarrant TV. It's incredible. Tony, good morning.
Good morning.
How are you? Nice to see you.
Very well.
What have you got for us here?
It's a Yamaha Thunder Ace. It's the new model for 1996.
The new model for 1996. Do you know Aubrey?
Yes.
He's our road tester. He's been rushing around on an 850 this morning, haven't you?
We have indeed.
Yep.
But this is what? This is a bit even bigger.
Oh, this is the new model from Yamaha, their flagship sports touring machine.
Yeah.
1,000cc.
You told me you were driving it yesterday, 1,000cc?
Yes, down to Brands Hatch to watch the World Superbike.
Yeah. So what will this one do? What's the top speed on this?
It's pretty academic, but it's 170 mile an hour.
That's 100 miles over the limit. I hope you're not going to do that this afternoon.
No.
That is an amazing looking piece of machinery, isn't it? So how's business anyway down at the Thruxton?
Very, very good indeed, yeah. It's, this time of the year is always our busy time.
Yeah. How long have you been here now, Tony?
In this particular shop, 16 years. But in the business has been going for 24 years.
Really?
Yeah.
So another local success story. We had one in Salisbury this morning. Good. So another one here.
Yeah, very much so, yeah.
And business is good, is it?
Very good indeed.
This is the time of the year, as I was saying this morning, that you're going to sell bikes, aren't you?
Yeah, and this year's been particularly good as well. New registrations are up, so perhaps...
It's all P-reg now, isn't it?
Yes. I think it's fair to say that the bikes are definitely enjoying a bit of a comeback at the moment.
Well, some beautiful bikes around, isn't there? Some absolutely amazing.
Yeah.
And we were in Salisbury this morning and all these foreigners are turning up on their bikes from nowhere. It's amazing.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. If you'd been on the road with me yesterday, you would have seen literally thousands of bikes out there yesterday.
Well, splendid. Okay, well, we're going to let Aubrey have a go on this. Okay. You looking forward to this one?
I am indeed. The last thing I rode this size in Yamaha was an FJ1200.
Yep.
Which I owned 2 or 3 years ago, and this is sort of... that's become a bit of an antique now.
Really? This is very smart, a 96 bike. Well, here he is, the intrepid Aubrey. So how was the A303, all right?
The A303 was wonderful. An amazing piece of road for this machine.
Really?
Yes,
really.
Wonderful piece of machine.
Let me just let you take your helmet off. So, the difference between this one and the other one?
This is an out-and-out touring bike.
Yeah.
What they would describe as the sports tourer.
Yeah.
Smooth, efficient, delivers the power smoothly, fairly flexible within its gear ranges.
Yeah.
You could ride to the south tip of Italy on this,
really?
With no problem at all.
And as Tony was saying, it does do 170 or so.
It delivers its power very smoothly and very quickly.
Yeah.
It's a very, very comfortable bike to ride, whether it be at slow speeds or fast speeds.
So, whatever you want, I think both of these have come out very, very well, haven't they?
They have, yes. Different horses for different courses.
Yeah.
You know, they're going to appeal to a different type of rider, but they're both excellent machines for the money.
Okay. Let's just a quick chat about British bikes like Norton. Are they still in existence? Are they still going? I presume
Good
they
question.
Are.
Good question.
I saw one just now and I thought, where have we lost it, the British, with our bikes? Like the Olympics, really. We can't even, we won one gold medal.
We lost it because we didn't see tomorrow.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, which is the unfortunately one of the sad parts about the British forward thinking.
Yeah.
I'm not sure whether it's the way we are or the way our politics are or just an unfortunate way it puts itself together. But the Japanese caught us up and overtook us.
Yeah. Oh, it's such a shame, but they are producing great bikes and Never mind. As I say, and thanks to both dealerships this morning for lending us a bike, and thank you, Aubrey, for testing them.
Oh, my pleasure.
Okay. And hopefully see you in a couple of weeks. If I can get that Ferrari I promised you, we'll do it.
Yes, definitely.
Right.
Definitely.
Maybe an Aston Martin, but yeah, it'll be something really good. But yeah, I mean, you are totally qualified to do everything, aren't you?
Yes,
I think the viewers should know that.
Yes, I'm qualified to ride and drive virtually anything you care to want to throw at me.
So, and you teach people to drive lorries or trucks or...?
Yeah, lorries, trucks, buses, motorcycles. Really? If it moves, we teach it.
So this man is very, very serious in what he's doing. So just remember that when we're doing our road tests, you know, we are very, very safety conscious. So as I say, thanks for coming this morning.
Thank you.
And thanks for watching this great test. Thank you, Aubrey.
Thank you.
Okay. Bye for now.
About a year since we came down to Mind, which is opposite the police station in Andover, to find out what was going on, see if there was anything new happening. They got the shop here, it's a wonderful shop, with bargains in there, so come down, because it's all for a charity, and a very worthwhile charity indeed. Well, some of the things that they actually get made for them and delivered off, because people are very, very kind, drop these off. You get furniture that's dropped off, anything you got that you can do without. Take it down here to Mind, because they will make good use of it and sell it, even if it needs to be fixed, because they've got a little workshop inside which fixes things. Now, I'm going to speak to Anne Casson, who's the coordinator, who I met the last time, so I'm looking forward to seeing Anne again. Hello, Anne.
Hello.
Nice to see you again.
Nice to see you.
Can I sit down?
Please do.
Right, tell me, it's about a year since we've been here. And this is the third time we've been here.
That's right.
What's new?
Quite a few things, really. We have about 114 clients now attending regularly. We're still open the 52 hours a week, which is quite a lot. The level of care sometimes is of a higher level than we anticipated, so we've actually taken on some extra staff for care.
This is paid staff?
Yes. Yes, it's had to be paid, experienced staff. We've opened a new group for parents and children, which is an outreach group during the school holidays.
And where's that based?
At the bungalow on Admiral's Way. It's called the Churchill Bungalow. It's a community bungalow. So that's a good group, which is a new venture for us. And it's quite successful.
So you're still cooking the meals here every day?
Oh, yes.
7 days a week?
6 days and snacks on Saturdays.
Oh, right.
Yes, very good value. Yeah, £1 for a meal, 30p for a suite. Not open to the public.
How many people would you normally get in here in the course of a day?
The average over the week is 41 per day.
Well, that's a lot of people, isn't
yes.
it?
Yes. Some people stay all day. We're open from 9.30 to 4.30. And some people come in lunchtime and wander off about 2.30, 2 o'clock, whatever they want to do. We also bring clients in on our minibus from the local area. And we have voluntary drivers to bring in clients from outlying villages.
Well, with this minibus, do you go out on outings and things in the minibus?
Oh, definitely, yes.
Where would you go to then?
Swanage, Bath, up to London, quite a few places. And clients choose where they'd like to go. Very client-led.
Well, I suppose we better explain for the benefit of people who've just got new cable, getting Town TV for the first time, that what exactly do you do here?
We support people with mental health problems, enduring mental health problems. And we work very closely with psychiatric teams, psychiatrists, GPs, etc. And this upstairs, which is a large area, is a drop-in centre, and it's very casual. There's a pool table, easy areas with armchairs and settees. There's snacks and coffee and tea available all day long, every day. And as I say, we're open weekends as well, Saturdays and Sundays too, and two evenings a week. So it's 7 days a week and two evenings.
So you're still looking for volunteers to help?
Oh, desperately, please. Please. Yes, we do need volunteers. It's a very happy atmosphere here. We have a lot of fun. We have a lot of social dances, different variety of activities going on. If you've got any skills and just like people, please come in and see me. I'd love to meet you.
Well, there's a great atmosphere in here. I felt it every time I came in. It's a wonderful atmosphere.
Thank you.
And everybody seems to enjoy themselves here.
Yes, they do. Even me.
Even you. And you've got to work here.
And I work here. And I think it's a wonderful project. I honestly do. We also need donations for the shop, please. We sell furniture. We sell furniture. bric-a-brac clothes, anything you can that we can sell, please bring it down to us. We're right opposite the police station, so you've got easy access in your car. But we do have double yellow lines outside, so please don't stay too long.
Oh dear, my car's parked in a double yellow line.
That's all right. I'm a friend of the traffic wardens.
So am I. Now, when people come in here for the first time, you show them around and explain what the whole thing is about. Do they feel nervous when they come in for the first time?
Is this volunteers?
No, I'm talking about clients that come in here.
Clients would come in supported by a support worker or a psychiatric nurse. Everybody has to be referred here.
Yeah.
You can refer yourself, but we would be looking for a GP, psychiatric nurse, psychiatrist. So, and everybody is supported. We have really experienced staff. And it's such so friendly upstairs that you're soon made very welcome.
Now, if somebody wants to have a chat, if they've got a particular problem, do you give counselling from here as well?
No, we don't actually do counselling. We do one-to-one, which is active listening. So we listen to people. We can refer them on to different agencies. If someone's got a problem about someone in their family, please feel free to come in and see us. You're more than welcome, and we can help.
That's all strictly confidential as well.
Oh, entirely, entirely confidential. There's never a problem about that.
So you say it's referrals from a doctor or a psychiatrist.
Yes.
Psychiatrist will put them in touch with you here.
Oh, yes, yes, often. As I say, if anybody, often we get people who come in and want information, and we've got free booklets that people are more than welcome to come in and take.
Now tell me about, this is not the only premises that you've got. You've got other places outside this premises.
Yes, we've got four outreach groups all together. One is an elder group for people with senile dementia. That's held at Leckford. Senile dementia, depression, and that is solely for elderly.
So how do they get out to Leckford, say, from Andover?
By minibus and by car. A lot of them live out in the villages, so they're all picked up. And that's a lunch club, that's an all-day group, and they use the minibus to go out on trips in the afternoons, and they love it. It's very popular, but we keep that small on purpose. Yeah. Because it's part of the spirit of that group to be small and intimate. We have a parent and children group, which is, as I say, new this year.
How's that going? Is it very popular?
Yes, it's working out very well. They've got swing ball and football. They make cookies, and loads of stuff goes on there. I'm just glad I'm not there. And we also have a parent and toddler group, which is really successful. That's been working for some years.
Where is that?
And that's at the sports centre in the Thomas the Tank Engine room on a Friday afternoon. It's all mums at the moment, but dads are more than welcome to come. People get a lot of support from there.
So, Anne, that's three. What's the fourth one?
The fourth one is a small craft group, which is held at a lady's home on a Thursday afternoon.
And is that popular as well?
Oh, yes. It's the same. Well, it's quite small, the same three ladies go all the time.
Are they volunteers?
No, they're clients. It's run by a volunteer in our own home.
Uh-huh.
Mm. Because some of these ladies don't like to come into a big, large building, but someone's own home is an advantage. Yeah,
it's more intimate, I suppose.
Yes, that's right. It's more like friends meeting over a cup of tea, really, and having a chat and doing craft.
Anne, thanks very much for talking to us.
You're more than welcome. It's lovely to see you again. Thanks.
It's great to see you. And can we come back again?
Oh, please do, any time.
Thanks, Anne.
Some volunteers.
Oh, we'll bring them all in.
Thanks very much.
Thanks. We'll be right back.
Chorderton Rare Breeds Farm Park has something for all ages. Beautiful gardens, lots of friendly animals to touch, feed and sit with. Visit Rabbit World, which is one of the largest collections in the world. See the famous pig races, enjoy a tractor and trailer ride, or let off steam in the play areas. We are open 10 till 6 daily. Admission is £3.50 for adults, £3 for senior citizens, and children are £2. Group rates are available. We are situated just off the A303 at the junction of the A338, 8 miles west of Andover. Phone 01980 629 438 for details.
It's music. CMT. It's television.
But I like it. I love it. I want some more of it.
Jim Goodland, Master Thatcher. Oh, yes, no less.
Oh, yes.
Jim, you're standing in front of one of your famous Thatches.
Yes.
Where are you based?
White Parish.
Where's that?
Near Romsey, about 10 miles out of Romsey.
Oh, not far from where we are now. What is all this? Is this a sort of binding to keep it from leaving the roof during storms and stuff?
As you go up the roof, on a normal roof, obviously, this would be a lot higher.
Mm.
And this would be the ridge, you know, when you see all the pretty patterns that come on a ridge.
Yes.
And that's the final seal on the top.
I see. Well, can you get quite creative with this thing? Can you make it...
Oh, you can, yeah.
Is that a skill that is independent to each different thatcher?
Yeah.
I see.
It is. It just depends what mood you're in on the day, you know. You might do a half scallop or some diamonds in there.
Oh, I see.
Or a big main feature on the centre. Under the chimney areas. These are called spars, and that's what holds all the thatch on. All the patterns on the roofs are made with spars. And
you mean these patterns we were talking about before?
All the outside spar lines that you see on ridges are all done with these. This is what holds the straw on the actual roof. And you twist it in the middle.
Oh, well, I never.
Like that. And it turns into like a big staple with points on the ends. And you go through the new straw, and you use the old coat as a base coat. So when you put a new thatch on, you thatch onto the old coat, and that's where you get that big tea cozy look where thatches really hug houses, you know.
And so you're saying you build a new hatch over an old hatch. So what happens when you've had three or four hatches? The roof becomes bigger than the
house. Oh yeah, you can have a thatch which can be up to 6 foot thick.
Really?
Yeah, oh yeah, yeah. These are the spars, like I say, that hold the ridge on, and you push them through and you push them in. And deep down inside there'll be a strengthening line to keep these nice and tight once you've hit them in. And you work your way along the ridge like this, and every now and again, after you've done about 3 or 4 feet, you go down your ladder, go across the road, mind the cars.
And have a look and see if it's straight.
Look up and make sure it's straight. And then any readjustments you can do when you get back up there. Now this is called a drift. And what it is, it's a lot of grooves there. And when you thatch a roof, you shape the whole roof with one of these when you're doing a cone wheat straw or a water reed roof. So you put your straw on by hand, obviously, and then you shape it up with this to get it exactly how you want it.
Does it shave at all?
No, it doesn't shave it. It just hits each individual straw and pushes it into place.
You're getting quite a lot of...
Little bits coming
excess,
off. Yeah, that's just the flat on it. So you do that on a whole roof.
Right. And what about these shears and the sort of the fancy edges?
Yeah, well then, when you've done that, when you've got your outside spar lines on your ridge, you then go back and you start to shape the pattern. When you see all those lovely scallops and...
What if you do one wrong cut and you've done the whole roof?
Well, then you just have to start again.
No! Do you ever make mistakes, or do you just sort of change the shape
that's
and make it a flower instead of a heart?
I've lost so much hair.
Oh, the worry.
No, you just have to. If you do make a mistake, if you went, say you went in too far there, then you'd have to match it up all the way along.
So when we go along now, we see these cottages with odd shapes, and they've made loads of mistakes. It's not creative,
too much cider.
How did you get into thatching?
Well, my grandfather was a thatcher, and my uncle was a thatcher, and I went to work with him, and then he ran off to London with a nurse. So,
do we want that on camera?
So then I packed it up for about 15, no, it's been about 10, 12 years.
But they're still very happy, and that's the main thing.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
So then you started up on your own?
Yeah, well, I did. I went through the old hippie period, you know. I
was one of
the. I had to give it up.
You didn't cut it, it just kind of went.
That's right, yeah.
Just these little rag dolls over here, they're scarecrows, are they?
Well, yeah, I did a show at Eastleigh, and there was a woman, and she was a professional scarecrow maker. She was 65 and completely mad. And her friend was about 85, and
they say it takes one to recognise one,
Well, that's right, yeah. I did identify with her, yeah. And she made me this one here, and I just brought it along.
He's a sweetie.
For my kids to do, and there's one here, and Lucy did that, and I said, God, that looked just like Elvis Presley if you put a face on, so she did, and that's it.
Aww.
Elvis Presley, only £5.
All it needs now is a microphone and a voice.
Yeah, it's just for my children to play around with, really. And the other kids come along and have fun, it's really good.
You know,
there's a lot of things to do here. It's a really good show.
Well, it's been great to meet you. Enjoy the rest of your day.
Pleasure.
Thanks.
Okay. Bye.
You're so brave, you haven't got your hat on.
I can't afford to.
What is it about putting hats with mesh on? You suddenly get an itch where you can't scratch it.
Well, that's called life. You get used to these problems.
I can't believe you're doing that. How come? Is it just you know they're not going to go for your head?
No, the bees will sting. But these particular bees are very carefully bred, and the queen's artificially inseminated.
Right.
And she's bred to be docile.
Oh, I see.
So they're very soft bees, easy to handle. Ideal honey gatherers. And ideal for commercial beekeepers.
Where is your company based?
I live in Kings Langley in Hertfordshire, and my bees are locally on the farms around the local valley.
So your bees have had a little journey today on the M25?
Yes, we've come about, I don't know, 90 miles.
90 miles? They're exhausted. They're not going to sting me. I'm not scared. Take this hat off me.
Not very wise.
How many jars of honey do you make a year, Alan?
My bees, typical hive, will produce between 100 and 150 pound of honey per year, per hive.
And how many jars does that make?
150 pound will be about 200 jars of honey.
Right.
That's from one hive.
You're selling... and how many hives do you have?
Oh, about 70.
Ah, I was going to say, because you've got nearly that whole selection down here today, haven't you?
A lot of what we sell is actually honey-based products. It's marmalades, pickles, mustards.
Oh, I see.
Obviously, honey-based and beeswax cosmetics, candles, a whole spectrum of what you can do with honey and beeswax.
Yeah.
We actually do a whole range of stuff. It tends to be a bit boring if you just do honey.
Yeah.
So we tend to...
Boring for you.
Well, and for the public.
Yes, okay.
They want to see and taste more than just honey.
Why are you touching them with your hands? Do you just want to look really sort of tough on camera?
No, it's a demonstration for the public.
What are you demonstrating them by touching
them?
That
you can handle bees and not be stung, so therefore you don't need to be afraid of them.
But that's only because the queen bee is artificially inseminated, as you were saying.
Because she's a well-bred young lady.
I see. Been to public school and all that stuff. Can I touch one? What would upset them? Ha!
Smells, basically.
Well, really? Go on, put one on me. Go on. Whee. You've seen Dangerous Brian, this is Dangerous Sarah.
It's fine to be.
Oh, look. I say. Come on, come and get me. I'm not frightened of you.
What you actually have, if you open it up slightly, you can see the nectar in there shining.
Yeah. Oh, yes.
But this dark capped area is the brood. And under there are the young larval bees pupating. Mm-hmm. And on the edge here is the honey.
Mm-hmm.
And in the cells there, the yellow stuff, is actually the pollen.
Mm-hmm.
And they collect pollen and nectar separately and store it separately.
Oh, is
it?
Why is that?
Well, the pollen is generally used as food for the younger bees because it's pure protein.
Mm-hmm.
And they mix it with honey to actually preserve the pollen. The honey is produced from nectar and it's used to feed the mature bees
mm-hmm.
when there's nothing coming in the way of nectar for the winter. It's basically surplus food.
Oh, so they're looking ahead and planning.
Yes, and little old me comes along and steals it. Well, a typical colony would be about 60,000 bees. And of those 60,000, about 2,000 will be drones or male bees. The rest of the colony will be female, which are the workers. Quite right, too.
So what,
do
all the boys do then?
Well, if they get the chance, they will inseminate the virgin queen.
So that's all they do?
That's their sole job in life.
They've got an easy life then, haven't they? A bit like you.
But if the mating is successful, they will die.
Of course.
Absolutely. They don't survive the mating.
No.
So then it's sort of this time of year, early August, the bees begin to settle down for the winter and they actually throw all the drones out that are left to die. They don't keep the drones. They're just disposed of.
Mm.
And that's what they do.
This is quite exciting because I love honey. Oh, I've just realised I can't get it. Right. Oh, marvellous. In the hatch. Look, what exactly are they doing there?
Well, having opened up the honey in there and also here, it's loose. They don't like that. It's messy in the colony. So what they do, they go in quickly and they stick their tongues into the honey like a straw and they lap it up and swallow it. And then at some point they will then regurgitate the honey back into these cells for storage.
Okay, you were just telling me something. It's really funny because Jason, who's behind that camera right now, walked in to film the bees going to bed.
He did, and he was in the flight path.
He was in the flight path.
Yes.
So how did you explain that?
Well, basically, the bees, when they go from A to B, which is from home to the nectar, fly in what's called a bee line. They go in a dead straight line.
And that's how you get the expression, I'm making a bee line for something.
Yes,
amazing.
That's where it comes from. And busy as a bee.
From beekeeping. I knew that one, but I didn't
know. There's lots of them.
It's amazing, isn't it?
Yes.
Lovely. Well, Alan, it's been a huge pleasure. We thoroughly enjoyed the show today, and the culmination has been...
You didn't get stung. Don't wave at the bees, they won't wave back.
we're going home now. I'm really going to miss this place. And safe journey back to Hertfordshire. Do you wear your mask in the van, or do you just lock them in?
I have done before now, when the flies tipped over and broken open. But we don't discuss that.
No, we won't discuss that. Well, that's the end of another lovely long sunny day down in the south. We've just finished with Alan the beekeeper. We've seen Mad Wacko and I tell you what, all the people we've met today, I don't think it's Broadlands, I've renamed it Madlands. We've had a great time. It's just a shame we didn't have time to see everybody because there was so much going on, but we just ran out of time. So I'm going home now and it's back to the studio. Bye.
Findleydown Farm is one of the South's number one farm visits. Family run, it offers a touch and learn experience for children with special sessions where they can feed, groom and hold the animals. Don't miss the playground, gypsy caravans, barn of bygones, picnic area and the rooster rest tea rooms. Open every day, admission is £3.50 for adults, £3 for seated citizens and £2.50 for children between the ages of 3 to 14. A family ticket for two adults and two children is only £11. Findleydown Farm Park is situated 2 miles east of Andover. Look out for the brown signs. For more information, phone Andover 352 or 195.
Hello, I'm Ben Wilson with a roundup of the news from your premier weekly newspapers, the Andover Advertiser and Salisbury Journal. Angry residents from the Weyhill area are seeking court action in an attempt to halt the invasion of 200 Newbury bypass security guards. International security company Pinkerton's shipped them in at the weekend to live in the former Rossay Hotel. It only took a week to complete a deal to buy the site, which had been on the market at £360,000, and porter cabins were shipped in without planning permission. So surprise, surprise, without the cameras, is how Lynn Hall describes her best friend's efforts to reunite her with the father she thought dead. It's been 33 years since Lynn, of Admiral's Way, last saw Father Charles, but thanks to a neighbour, the pair are soon to be reunited. I was 8 when I last saw him, so it's hard to take in, said Lynn. Former Harroway pupil Kerry Connolly has earned a part in a top London show, Lord of the Dance. Opening at the Coliseum recently, the colourful production also stars Michael Flatley of Riverdance fame. Kerry left Harroway 2 years ago and went back to Ireland to concentrate on Irish dancing that she has practised since a very young age. An Andover mother appeared in Winchester Crown Court this week, accused of shaking her 14-day-old baby so violently that it suffered brain damage. Mary Butcher, aged 23, of Admiral's Way, is said to have moved baby Thomas back and forth so hard that it caused brain hemorrhaging. She has pleaded not guilty to unlawfully causing grievous bodily harm. The case is proceeding. Cries of agony were heard coming from the Winton Mass blocks recently as a very brave man gave up his leg hair for charity. Nick Price, head of Mass and ex-possessor of hairy shins, foolishly agreed to the plans of 4 Year 10 girls. As the time approached, I had an overwhelming sense of doom, said Mr. Price. Help is needed by a charity which assists babies and toddlers in Luggershaw and Tidworth cope with parenting. Homestart gives families with under fives a friend and is looking for more volunteer visitors to support those in need. There are already 28 volunteers and anyone interested should call Homestart on 01980 843913. Bishopdown, Salisbury's fastest growing suburb, could soon have its own hotel. Plans for a 40-bedroom travel-in providing 75 full and part-time jobs were unveiled this week by Brewers Fair. South Wiltshire's mystery big cat is back. Surveyor John Hutton of Alderbury was driving between Farley and Pitton when he and two other passengers spotted the cat. We saw the back end of the animal with its long tail as it lumbered up the bank and disappeared. I stopped the car, but we didn't get out, said Mr. Hutton. Food giants Waitrose have cleared the final hurdle in their marathon battle to build a superstore on the site of the former cattle market in Ashley Road, Salisbury. The revised design was approved by councillors last week. A Salisbury district councillor, David Parker, has urged English Heritage not to go over the top with its plans for Stonehenge. Some of the schemes that have been put forward are complete nonsense, he said. We're hearing about domes, McDonald's, restaurants and Disney-like theme parks. The myth and mystery of the site could be lost forever if the wrong choice is made, said Mr. Parker. An horrific injury to Havant striker John Crompton forced a premature end to Salisbury City's third pre-season friendly at Victoria Park. Crompton shattered bones in his left leg in a tackle and left the ground in an ambulance. The match was abandoned with the scores at 1-1. And finally, Egyptian vulture caviar from the Hawk Conservancy is one bird who does not mind getting egg on his face, and that's no yolk. At 9 weeks old, he is already copying wild vultures by using stones to throw at eggs before tucking in, although Conservancy Director Ashley Smith admits his lack of aim is a handicap. This has been the news from the Andover Advertiser and Salisbury Journal. I'm Ben Wilson reporting.
We seem to be full of bike and car tests on Town TV this week, and we've been asked to come over to Hayden Garages here in Salisbury to have a look at the new wonderful Lotus. It's a beautiful day, the sun's shining, rather windy, but it's the ideal day to take your top off, I suppose you could say that. And here it is, the new Lotus Elise. We'll be right back. Well, we've stopped up near Salisbury Racecourse, and I'm with Paul Brewer from Hayden Cars. Morning, Paul. You trusted me to drive you.
Yeah, no problem at all.
Yeah, it's a wonderful little car, isn't it?
Yeah, it's leading edge of technology, an aluminium tub chassis, weighing 690 kilos, with a quite outstanding performance.
It feels like a mini Ferrari. I was just saying that it's a nice little gate box on it almost, isn't it? And it's very, very quick.
Very swift, 118 horsepower, 0 to 60 in 5.9 seconds, and 130 odd miles an hour.
130 miles an hour. Well, we're going to take it down to the dual carriageway. We're not going to do 130 miles an hour, but we'll be within the limit. But it's a great little car. I think it's great. But what's it made out of?
It's a glass fibre body over an aluminium tub chassis.
Okay. Right, you got that, viewers? Right, we're going to go for a little spin. If I can get in the thing, it's... you've got to be a bit agile to get in here, and agile is sometimes up, but I'm not. Especially after a heavy weekend. Oh. Well, there we are. This is certainly an amazing little motor car, Paul. It's fantastic. As you say, it's built almost like a racing car in here, and it's really solid, isn't it?
Yeah, and that's the aluminium chassis that I mentioned earlier.
Yeah.
The car's really the epitome of less is more, as you can see, instrumentation, etc. It's very, very sparse, but it gives you a real racy feel.
Yeah, no, it's certainly a racer. It reminds me a bit of a Marcus. Do you remember we did the road test on the Marcus? It's very similar to that, slightly, obviously, smaller in scale, but it's... quite a lethal car to drive. It's amazingly quick, as you saw. And we're going to head back into Salisbury now and just take it into the Rose and Crown by the river and maybe have a little toasted sandwich or something. Definitely not a glass of wine driving this, because you've got to be really on your toes to drive this Lotus. It's fantastic. And thank you very much, Paul. And thanks to Hayden Cars for the ride this morning. I think I might get one of these. I have to raid the piggy bank. Okay, you'll take my order though, won't you?
Will indeed, £1,000.
£1,000 deposit.
And delivery in about 13 months.
What is the price, by the way?
£19,950.
Okay, there we go. That's the and it's 0 to 60 in what was it?
5.8 seconds.
And top speed of?
130 miles an hour.
There we are. If you've got all that, these are great little cars. I can't find anything wrong with it. The only thing is, I think if you're about 24 stone, you'd have trouble getting in. But apart from that, it's a great, great car to drive. So, we'll see you at the Rose and Crown. Bye for now. Well, there we are, as promised, the Rose and Crown at Harnham. Now, Paul Brewer here, he's going back to the garage, aren't you?
I am, sell a few more cars.
You are. Well, I'm going to sit by the riverbank, so I'll see you by the riverbank. Thank you very much, Simon. That's wonderful. Regulation spritzer. Thank goodness I'm not driving that Lotus anymore. What an amazing car that was. As promised, I brought you to the Rose and Crown at Harnham. Absolutely glorious day here on the river. It's absolutely sensational. And I'm here with Jonathan Aldwood, the general manager of the Rose and Crown. Good morning.
Morning.
Thank you for welcoming us. A little surprise visit from Town TV.
You're welcome. It's nice to see you.
Beautiful location here.
Yeah, it's absolutely fantastic, and sort of a bit of a hidden treasure in the hustle and bustle of Salisbury, and sitting here, it's like a sort of little haven.
I must confess, I didn't know this was here, and I shall certainly come again, because lovely tables, lovely menu.
Yeah, I mean, it's a lovely spot, really. It's something that's got lots of different things. You know, we've got the gardens, the river, and top cuisine to go with it.
How old is the Rose and Crown?
It dates back to the 13th century, and we've actually got half the hotel is still the original building, and half is obviously a new extension. But we've got eight bedrooms that still have the original features, and the restaurant and the kitchens and reception and the old public bars are still in the, you know, in the original part. So it's still got a lot of old character about the place.
And it's almost a view, isn't it, of the Constable painting?
Yeah, I mean, Constable actually painted his famous shot of Harnham Bridge looking across the cathedral from about 10 yards from where we're sitting now.
Really, it's amazing.
And I don't think the shot actually has changed very much in the hundreds of years since he painted it.
It's a beautiful occasion, I must admit. We're going to be coming back, I think, in a couple of weeks' time to talk to your chef. What's his name?
It's John Tobin, and John's actually been chef here for 21 years.
Has he, by Jove?
Yes.
So he can show us a thing or two, then?
I think he's seen a few changes and a few comings and goings, but, I mean, he's sort of consistently kept high standards and is well-known in Salisbury for the style of cuisine that he serves.
Wonderful. Okay, we're going to be coming back in a couple of weeks. Tell me about tourism in Salisbury. Are you full of lots of Americans this year?
Yeah, we've had an excellent June and July. We have had a lot of tourists, Germans, Americans, Swedish. So obviously Salisbury is still a very popular destination. And where better to come and spend your break than at the Rose and Crown?
Well, that's a very good plug. Why not? It really is beautiful. Beautiful stretch of the river and beautiful countryside. Well, Jonathan, thanks for inviting us this morning. I know you're going to be really busy for lunch in a minute.
Yeah, looking forward to another busy lunch on the river. Thanks very much for coming.
Okay, well, I'm going to have my spritzer, and we'll see you back on the road, but I'm not going to be driving, so thanks for watching the Lotus Road Test. Bye for now. It's raining again.
No. We've been very lucky for the last couple of weeks, though, haven't we?
I know. We've got this big 60s bash up at Rushmore Arena at the weekend.
Yeah.
Hopefully it's not going to be bucketing down with rain. But
are we going to play up there or what?
I think the roadshow is going to be there. Yeah, okay. Town TV roadshow is going to be there. I think we're going to be introducing some of the acts like the Tremolos and the Searchers and the Swinging Blue Jeans and the
Trogs.
Oh, God, they're all up there. Anyway, we've got three pairs of tickets to win for that. And thank you everybody that went in for the competition. What we're going to do, we're going to roll over the second half of the prize, which is the meal for two at the Shears at Collingbourne Juices, because we want loads of you to ring in, but as this is this weekend, we're going to have to do this one now. So all those people who went in for it, your name will go back in the golden bucket next week for the Shears as well. And the question is, which county is Collingbourne Juices in? Hmm. Is it Hampshire or Wiltshire?
A lot of people got that wrong.
A lot of people got that wrong. So just put your thinking caps on. Which county is Collingbourne Juices in? Is it Hampshire or Wiltshire? And ring us on 390. Or fax us on 390.
391.
Or you can ring us on Salisbury 555.
222.
Or you can write to us at 555. P.O. Box 555 Andover. But we're just going to do the draw now for these two sets of tickets. Three sets of tickets for the Rushmore Arena. Sunday the 11th of August. If you're watching the show after that, obviously you missed it. But
it's the biggest 60s show ever. They've got 10 bands on there.
About 20,000 people. It's huge. Army are going to be there. Funfair, refreshment marquees, and much, much more. Sounds like
still
wet, wet, wet.
There,
right. The first one's coming out now for this great prize. So just make sure you can get up to Rushmore Arena. We've got Sheila Hill. Looks like an Andover number. You won two. So that's two for Sheila. Put those there. And I'll go again.
Go again.
What we got here? We've got Stan Gainsford. Well done, Stan. You've got two tickets. Let's have a look. Hope you like 60s music. Go on, you do the last one. So it's this Sunday, the 11th of August. So if you're watching after that, there we go. Here's the Salisbury number, Colin Cook. Well done, Colin. You won the last two tickets for the event this weekend. We'll get on the phone to you today and let you know you won, so you can all go on Sunday. Really good, worthwhile tickets. Cost a lot of money.
Yeah.
Right.
We've all got to go back in again.
Yeah, they're all going to go back in the golden bucket for next week, because you're all in with a chance of winning that meal for two at the Shears. We're probably, knowing us, we'll probably add something else to it as well, won't we?
Most probably.
Like a trip up the Eiffel Tower or something, I don't know.
You reckon?
Yeah, well, you never know. You never know on Town TV, we do anything. Anyway, call us if you know that answer on Andover 390.
390.
Salisbury 555.
222.
Or fax us on 390.
391.
Or write to us, PO Box 555, Andover. Thanks for watching the show, and we'll see you all again next week. Bye.
Bye.